Hello and welcome to our next lecture. Today we focus on the concept of autonomy and we'll be talking about its role in foreign language learning. Well, let me start from posing a question. Why are we actually talking about autonomy? Is autonomy important, significant in foreign language classroom? Well, let's have a look at dot points. The first argument for our discussion about autonomy is a great interest in the theory and practice of autonomous learning and teaching. There are lots of publications, lots of articles and books in which the authors acknowledge the significance of autonomy. The most important authors are Benson or David Little. And from all these papers, right, and books, one idea prevails, namely that autonomy is a prerequisite for effective language learning. In other words, these learners who are autonomous, who are independent, are able to take responsibility for their own learning process, are at the same time better, more successful language learners. And of course there is a widespread recognition for this concept of autonomy, but still there is some kind of debate among the researchers as to whether autonomy actually is the concept that appeals to all the learners. In other words, because it's a very autonomy, it's a very multifaceted construct, we cannot say that it's actually good for all the learners. Definitely, it may appeal and some other reasons for our discussing the issue of autonomy. Well, definitely it's a concept that is nowadays very fashionable. Teachers, psychologists or counselors, they recognize the significance of this concept and they notice that where students, learners and generally speaking people in different spheres of their lives, when they are autonomous, they are at the same time successful, right? More effective than their counterparts who are dependent on someone else. So, students who lack autonomy in foreign language learning may be described as learners who are disappointed, and they rely too much on teachers' guidance, on teachers' help. They don't know what actually works for them, what is good, what is bad. They have no awareness of effective learning strategies. And these learners are also set to and autonomous students, unlike there are not autonomous, right, learners, counterparts, that are more motivated. Actually, there are lots of studies, research findings that show that there is positive correlation between the level of students' autonomy and the level of motivation. These students are also set to use more learning strategies, that are aware of using learning strategies. And of course they do not rely on formal instruction so much, which means that well, the last statement about autonomous learners who actually do not need teachers is very disputable. So let's focus on the question. Is it really true that autonomous students are these who learn for a language without teachers? Question is a little bit tricky because there is no unequivocal answer to this question. So the answer is actually yes and no. There are some autonomous learners who actually need some kind of guidance on the part of the teacher, especially at the initial stages of their autonomy formation. In other words, they need teachers at the very beginning to show them how autonomy works, what autonomy is about, right? But later on, they become more and more independent of their teachers. But of course, there are some learners who do not need teachers at all, right? Well, there are some learners, and if we have a look back into the history, right, there are many successful learners who actually learned Latin or Greek or Hebrew, and they did it on their own, right, without any formal instruction. However, nowadays, when we are talking about autonomy, our association is more with institutionalized learning. So the main objective of this lecture is also to make you sensitive to the concept. And right now, let's have a look at historical background of the concept of autonomy and how this concept actually emerged. It has origins in both Western and Eastern philosophies. But as you have a look at this quotation from Benson and Bola, it is primarily in Western form that we know of them in education, which means that in Eastern philosophies, in Asia, for instance, right, the concept of autonomy is known, right? However, as it comes to education, it is not fostered in the way that it is fostered in Western education. Autonomy is frequently used interchangeably with the term of independence. We may come across these two terms in education, philosophy, psychology, and politics. And these two terms have appeared in many works since the 18th century. It has been associated with individual's ability to behave as a sensible member of society. But of course, if we want to adopt this term for the purpose of education, we need to make some changes, some amendments, right? So, in education fields, we understand autonomous behavior, autonomous education, as different ways in which individuals, they try to... And now let's have a look at some more information about the beginnings of autonomy. There are no doubts that the concept of autonomy is related to some social, political background. In Europe, this breakthrough moment, it was 1960s, when there were some voices of people, right, to improve quality of their lives. And in this way, the concept of autonomy became more and more dominant, prevailing, right? As it comes to education, the concept of autonomy was first introduced in 1971. It was implemented through the project that is known Council of Europe's Modern Languages Project. Originally, the project was designed to support lifelong learning of adult learners. However, in time, there were some amendments that were introduced into the project, and nowadays, the issue of autonomy, the concept of autonomy, is not... Well, the project that I mentioned before, was actually organized by University of Nantes in France. The researchers who were collaborating in this at this university, they founded the research center that is called CROPEL. CROPEL was a very influential education center at that time. There are two leading names associated with CROPEL, Yves Chalon and Henri Oleg. In Anglo-Saxon literature, right, he's known as Oleg. Well, the first researcher, Chalon, is actually well regarded as originator of CROPEL organization. He's also known as father of language learner autonomy. And after his death, Oleg became the leader of the whole organization. As I said before, originally, the main objective of this organization was to support lifelong learning of adult learners. However, later on, they also started dealing with various age groups. Lots of information that we have nowadays about different strategies that we may employ in the classroom, and in this way we develop autonomy, that actually come from very influential works of Henry Oleg. This organization also contributed to self-directed learning. I guess that it's worth mentioning different definitions of autonomy, because as I mentioned before, autonomy is a very multifaceted notion, term. There are lots of different approaches to this notion, and many definitions were worked out by researchers. The very first definition was worked out by Oleg, right, in his seminal report. This report is actually nowadays one of the most crucial documents referring to autonomy research. In this document, we may read out that autonomy is ability to take charge of one's own learning. What is more, an outcome of self-directed learning is also emphasized. What does it mean? It means that learners are able to to determine their objectives of learning. They also determine progress, whether they want to learn at a slow pace or faster rate, right? And they are also able to evaluate their own learning process. This point is, let's start from discussing the issue of self-directed learning. The crucial, actually, concept that is discussed in the seminal report by Oleg. If you have a look at our subtitle, it says that self-directed learning is not learning in isolation. Actually, many laymen think that, well, being autonomous, it means you learn without any teachers, you learn in isolation. Not in a classroom, but outside a classroom without any teachers. However, this approach to understanding the concept of autonomy was in the past. Nowadays, autonomy is understood not as learning in isolation, but more as collaboration with others, right? Plus interdependence. In several reports, Oleg focuses more on this aspect of autonomy which is related to isolation. So he emphasizes the role of self-access learning centers and learner training. He also emphasizes idea of individualization, right? Which means that if we want to have autonomous learners in a classroom, we should, as teachers, approach them individually, right? And finally, he also stresses the idea of learner-centeredness. So, classrooms were more centered on learners. But once again, it is how autonomy was perceived in the past, right? Nowadays, by autonomous behavior, we understand behavior that may be executed both in the classroom and outside the classroom, that may be achieved by learning alone, but also learning in collaboration with others. I don't know, by means of computers, right? You may use different podcasts, And now let's have a look at more formal definition that was put forward by David Little. Autonomy is a capacity for detachment, critical reflection, decision-making, and independent action. It presupposes but also entails that the learner will develop a particular kind of relation to the process, learning process of course, and the content of his learning. The capacity for autonomy will be displayed both in the way he or she transfers what has been learned to wider context. Okay, this is the quotation, right? I actually highlighted the most important keywords: detachment, critical reflection, decision making, and independent action. And a little bit of comment, right, on this quotation. This definition is not something that is totally different from Holleck's definition. I would call these definitions a kind of supplement or supplementary definition. But unlike the previous definition, it stresses the importance of cognition, all right? Cognitive processes that allow efficient organization of the learning content rather than how the learning process is organized. So, once again, to make the long story short, if we want to be autonomous learners, we should first organize our cognitive processes. We should start thinking in a different way, all right? Meaning we should start from, being able to make some autonomous decisions, being able to... And now, definition of autonomy, which is put forward by Dickinson, I guess that this definition is actually students' favorite, right? Because it's very short. Autonomy implies learners' complete freedom, with a stress on the word freedom, from the constraints of teachers and institutions they learn in. Oh, this definition is a little bit disputable. Well, can you imagine schools with total freedom and learners doing whatever you want to? Well, it's very, very disputable. So, my comment to this definition is that unlike other definitions, Dickinson's focuses on something that we may describe as full autonomy, total autonomy of our learners. And teachers and other learners, other peers, influence is excluded. So, in line with this definition, well, learners should be able to work independently of teachers, independently of any materials, resources prepared by teachers or correspondence. And finally, I think it's worth mentioning, definition of autonomy by Benson. Benson's view on autonomy is not very different from, other authors, right, definitions, but what I really like about his definition is that he acknowledges the importance of looking, right, or analyzing the concept of autonomy from different perspectives. which means that autonomy is not the concept that may be perceived in the same way by the learners from different settings, from different educational backgrounds, all right? So, well, if you have a look at, well, students of different age, from different age groups, and from different, well, cultural backgrounds, students from Asia, students from Australia, right, or European, American students, you will understand what he really means, what he has in mind. The way that we perceive autonomy depends to a great extent on our psyche, right? On our understanding of the very concept, and also it depends on politics, on the social concept. That's why he put forward. Let's start from technical version of autonomy. In this version, Benson emphasizes learner training, the significance of learner training and learner strategies for unsupervised learning. All right? And my brief comment is that autonomy refers here to the situation in which learners take charge of their learning and acquire L2, irrespective of teachers or educational. Well, as to psychological version of autonomy, it's related to the theory of constructivism. I guess that you remember the notion of constructivism, which is very fashionable approach nowadays, also fostered in education. I guess that you remember that in line with constructivism, each individual constructs reality, his own version of reality. So in this definition, maybe not definition, but in this version of autonomy, Benson recognizes the importance of our psyche, our psychological, I would call it readiness or willingness for being autonomous, for taking up responsibility, responsibility for our learning process. So, he discusses in this point some attitudes, cognitive abilities, which allow the learner to take responsibility for learning. And my brief comment is that in the promotion of autonomous behavior, learners use, for instance, self-directed learning, self-access, authentic interaction with native speakers. And finally, we have the last version of autonomy put forward by Benson, that is called political version, right? It's associated with the critical theory, assuming that the construction of knowledge relies on the dominant social and political philosophies. What does it mean? It means that where some individuals are not ready for autonomous behavior, if in their context, political context, the notion of autonomy does not exist, or it is not somehow promoted. Well, to give you an example, in many countries, let's say in the communist countries, autonomy is perceived as something negative, right? All people should be unified, standards, norms are promoted, but not being different, autonomous, working on your own. So, your attitudes, your beliefs, right, are shaped by social, political situation. And now let's focus on a question. Is autonomy and responsibility the same? Where is a boundary line between these two concepts? Well, frequently the researchers think about autonomy as being, well, the component of responsibility, or vice versa, responsibility being a component of a broader concept of autonomy. But you may also actually come across such a point of view that autonomy is equivalent to responsibility. But once again, well, it's very disputable whether an individual that is autonomous is also responsible, and vice versa. Is responsible learner, student, always autonomous? If you want to find more information about, well, this dispute, right, among the researchers, well, you may have a look at Charles and Chabot. Alright, we had to look at different definitions of learner autonomy, but I guess that, well, formal definitions might be boring and maybe not so, well, digestible for students, right? So let's have a look at characteristics of autonomous learners as enumerated by Omaggio. I think that in this form, right, this enumeration form is really appealing for students, and it may give you an idea what it means to be autonomous. Autonomous learners are, first of all, aware of their learning style and strategies. Alright? Now, if you think about foreign language learning, well, think about your teachers, or think about yourself as a teacher, right? And ask yourself a question. Do you know what your learning style is? Do you know what learning strategies are most effective for you and for your learning style? Number two, that are you active during learning process? What does it mean active? So you somehow reflect on the learning process. You know, alright, this strategy is good for me, but that one does not work for me, right? Or you're able to monitor your progress. You're able to say, alright, I learned today this or that, but still there is a long way for me to go. But I'm enthusiastic about taking some risk during learning. Right, so taking risk, personality feature you may say, but it's correlated with being autonomous. I also heard about some ideas of finding some correlation between extroversion, introversion and autonomy. But I guess that, well, saying that extroverts are more autonomous, it's a little bit far-fetched statement. Now have a look at the next point. Autonomous learners, they try to guess something which they do not know. So in other words, they are good guessers. They know from the context what a given grammatical structure or lexical item means. They pay attention both to fluency and accuracy. They make and test hypotheses about the target language. And finally, they are tolerant towards the culture of the target language. So, if we take all these points together, since there is some misunderstanding of the concept of autonomy, let's have a look at what autonomy is not. So definitely it is not a synonym for self-instruction. And it does not entail an abdication of responsibility on the part of a teacher. So it does not mean that autonomous learners do not need teachers at all, right? They do need teachers to give them some guidance, right? to show them some strategies, but later on these learners just test, make hypotheses about the effectiveness, right, of these strategies. And have a look, David Little also emphasizes that autonomy is not another teaching method, all right? It's not a method, it's not a technique. Autonomy is a broader psychological, I would say, concept that of course maybe are somehow executed by means of different teaching methods and different techniques. And finally, it is not a steady state achieved by learners. So it does not mean that once you, well, achieved autonomy in foreign language learning, you will have it for good. Alright? It is something that evolves, it takes a lot of time, and well, and definitely it's not. As you remember, I told you before that autonomy, developing autonomy, it's not a steady process, right? And it's not something that it's like this, right? But it takes some time. So we may find, distinguish some stages of autonomy development. The first one is raising awareness, which means that we as teachers, we make our students aware what autonomy is about. But of course, we do not make, you know, we do not introduce any boring definitions of autonomy, all right? But we do it in a practical way. Then we expect from our learners some changes in their attitudes, all right? So even if our students were not, you know, autonomous, we observe some slight changes. And finally, transferring roles is the last stage of autonomy development. The last stage refers to the situation in which the learner becomes more and more independent. You might have an impression that teacher is in the background, right? And the learner somehow takes authority over teacher, all right? That's why Shal and Chabot call this stage transferring roles. But it does not mean that a learner becomes a teacher and the teacher becomes a student, all right? But teacher becomes less and less visible and learner becomes more and more self-conscious, all right? Self-conscious of his learning process, all right? And of course, if we introduce these three stages of and now some technical advice on different ways of fostering autonomy. Well, let's have a look at a diagram that I borrowed from Benson, 2001. He actually suggests that there are different fields, subfields, in which autonomy may be fostered. So let's have a look, let's start from resource-based approaches, all right? We may ask our learners to work independently on their resources. But of course, it does not mean that you take away the course book and you say, all right, since that time, you work without any books, all right? But you introduce this process gradually. You might ask the students, I don't know, to work over some project, to prepare some handouts, and so on, right? Now, let's have a look at technology-based approaches. We may encourage our students, for instance, to learn by means of podcast or vidcast, right? And introduce more and more techniques like this into the classroom. Learner-based approaches, all right? Teacher-based approaches, classroom-based approaches in which we control making decisions in the classroom, all right? So we try to give some responsibility to our students. Let your students decide about activities in the classroom, some exercises, or the way they want to be actually tested. And curriculum-based approaches, all right, where you may say, well, students have no impact on curriculum. Well, yes and no, all right? Especially with adult learners, especially not in, public education, but at private language schools, well, you may discuss with your students what elements of curriculum you want to focus on and which of them are just irrelevant or not, or the students are not interested in them and you may just skip. All right, these ideas for fostering autonomy were taken from Benson, and well, you may say, well, still it's too theoretical. We want to have something that is, you know, something just like hands-on, based on hands-on experience. Tell me what works for the students. So, well, these are the tips, very practical pieces of advice for fostering autonomy in the classroom. Have a look at the first point. Encourage your learners to engage in independent learning by emphasizing its importance in the classroom. Assuring learners they possess a capacity for autonomous learning by offering them successful experiences of independent learning. I guess that, well, each of you experienced a situation in which you actually do not believe in your abilities, right? And, well, a teacher assigns some work to do and you say, well, it's not for me, it's too difficult for me, I'm not able to do it at home, right? So you may encourage your students for making this endeavor of autonomous learning, providing learning with genuine opportunities to practice independent learning. Talking just about autonomy in the classroom over and over again means nothing for our students. We need to do something practical. So, do not say to your students, well, you may come back home and, well, you may listen to real English by means of, well, podcast, all right? But first, introduce it in a classroom. Give them some samples of videcasts, podcasts, all right? Now, equipping them, your students, with proper learning techniques or strategies. Or you may say there is no time in the classroom for teaching your students how to learn, how to be independent. Well, you are right, but if you do it gradually, right, let's say 2 minutes, 2 up to 5 minutes, and you somehow, well, make this learning strategies introduction a part of a warm-up stage, right, it may be very, very effective for your learners. Now, making learners more aware of language as a system so they are able to employ all available learning strategies. What does it mean? If you just prepare a list of different learning strategies, let's say mnemonic techniques, right, for learning, successful learning of vocabulary, right? It means nothing for your students. You need to show to your students how it works in practice, all right? So prepare some exercises, maybe some extra additional homework, such as, well, think of 5 innovative ways of learning the following list of vocabulary. All right. Well, you may suggest to your students that there are some ways of, well, memorizing vocabulary by means of other languages that they know, and so on and so on. Now, the last point, sharing your own experience as a language learner to help students predict the outcomes of language learning tasks and learn how to overcome learning problems. Of course, the best source of information for your students is a teacher, himself or herself, right? If you explain to your students all the hurdles that you had to overcome in your own learning process, how difficult it was for you to overcome. If you still say, well, we understand nothing, give us more examples, have a look at these points. Project work. Excellent, actually, method for fostering autonomy of your students. And not just individual, because some teachers, well, they claim that all the projects have to be individual. Well, where your students may become independent, autonomous, even if they prepare the projects in a group of learners, right? Now, number two, introduce European language portfolio. We already discussed in the first term the document of ELP, and I guess that you remember that this is the perfect instrument for developing autonomy of your students, motivation of your students, self-reflection, self-evaluation, and so on and so on. Now, introduce both per group work and individual work. All right? Use self-assessment. So if you do not introduce ELP, we use self-assessment. All right? So if you assign a test to your students, do not check it on your own, but let your students to check the test on their own, or ask the students to employ peer assessment. They exchange the test and they check the test without any involvement of a teacher. Learner training, something that we already discussed. But ask your students what is really of, well, primary importance, priority for them. Maybe, well, learning your students how to, well, learn effectively vocabulary is not as important as learning how effectively learn, for instance, L2 pronunciation. And finally, have a look, freedom in choosing topics for discussions, exercises from the course books. Well, you may say, well, it's not always a good idea if we allow the students to decide about topics, tasks, exercises, I don't know, deadlines for homework and so on, right? But once again, autonomy, it is not something that we give to our students like it is. And finally, let's focus on the issue of individual differences and developing foreign language autonomy. I think that the most important individual difference is age. All right? And I guess that throughout this lecture, a question that arose in your mind was, well, it's not possible to introduce autonomous behavior in all the age groups, especially among child learners. It's impossible to give autonomy to the group of, well, 7 or 8 year olds who will sooner or later take advantage of a teacher. Well, actually, you are partly right, and autonomy may be introduced in different age groups on condition that we do it skillfully, right? So, there are no doubts that autonomy may be introduced regardless of learner's age. But of course, we should bear in mind that there are different techniques appropriate for different age groups. I guess that you remember that originally, autonomy in foreign language learning was introduced, or in general speaking, education was introduced for sustaining lifelong learning of adults. Why adults and not child learners or adolescent learners? Well, it's mainly because adults are the best learners. In the sense that they are able to understand and to perceive the objectives of learning. Alright? If you ask an adult person, why are you learning English? He or she will say, well, because I want to be promoted in my workplace, because I want to go abroad, because I want to, well, communicate with native speakers, and so on and so on. But it's not the case with child learners or adolescent learners. However, there is also one drawback of introducing autonomy to adults, right? When most of the time they have many, many duties, and because they are swamped with work, they have no time at home for some extra projects, extra homework, podcasts, videos, and so on, right? So even if they are involved in some, well, language learning process, right, they expect much from teachers. And it's not the case actually with adolescents and child learners, but child learners and adolescents have actually no expectations. It's not that they do not have any expectations, but they are just not aware that they might have any expectations, right? So, if you have a look at child learners, definitely teachers have much, much easier tasks with children than with adults. But, because they are not aware of the need of, well, being autonomous as learners, teachers should start from very short autonomous tasks. Alright? So you cannot give autonomy for child learners for 4 to 5 minutes, alright? Because where sooner or later where kids will take advantage of a teacher, and you know, the situation in the classroom will be very, very, well, it will be messy, and there will be complete chaos, right? But where you may introduce shorter deadlines, alright, and you may introduce some stricter teacher's control, where you may say, well, if there's teacher's control, this is not autonomy. Well, and you're partly right, because autonomy means that there is no teachers or any supervisors control. But because child learners are not ready, well, psychologically, mentally ready for autonomy, we need to introduce this autonomy stage by stage, and we need to control it, but just at initial stages. And of course, the last group is adolescents. Definitely it's the most challenging group in terms of autonomy development. Why is it challenging? Because it's the most problematic one. In the sense that teenagers are not prepared for responsibility. If you give them freedom, they really appreciate it, but they don't know how to, well, use this freedom in practice. But what is a great advantage of autonomy development in this particular age group? All right, and it's high time for my final thoughts. The first conclusion is that autonomous behavior needs to be developed over long period of time. All right? We cannot expect from our learners to grasp the idea of autonomy at once. And of course, not our learners in the classroom will be mentally, psychologically ready for autonomous behavior. I guess that you know that being independent, autonomous, it is something that is primarily fostered at home by our parents. So in these homes where the idea of autonomy is somehow enhanced, right, from the very, very beginning, it's easy later on for teachers or some other educational institutions to work with such a person who is very, very autonomous, right? What can we do as teachers, as parents? Well, as teachers, definitely we may sensitize the parents of our students to allow the learners that are kids to be autonomous at home. All right? So, where you, as future parents, you should think about all these situations in which overprotected mummies, overprotected daddies, they do something for their kids. So instead of saying, I can make shoelaces for you, well, say to your child, you can do it on your own, right? If we foster autonomy in this way, well, in the future, these kids, being learners, pre-language learners, will be able to say, well, you don't have to explain to me. I can practice the language on my own, right? I can somehow practice different strategies and test them, check which of them are effective for me or not, on my own, without you, teacher, right? And, of course, we should make our learners acquainted with assumptions of autonomy as early as possible, where this is the point that we discussed in reference to child learners, and make your kids involved in simple decision making. So it refers to all of you as future parents, all right? Let your child decide about, I don't know, the color of a skirt or trousers, right? Let your child decide what he or she wants to eat. So thank you for your attention, and right now get ready for developing your own autonomy.